Sonic, the heart of your system.
Hi guys, welcome back to another GGF video. And yes, you probably noticed already, today I'll be taking a look at the Z490 Aqua from ASRock. Now this video is quite long and I won't be covering every single detail on this board. I'll just be covering the main features. I'll be showcasing this board in a build and I'll do some VRM testing at the end. Now I also want to make note that the 999 pieces that are limited to this board, they aren't included in the media samples being sent out to media. So I just wanted to get that out of the way because I remember in the original X570 Aqua launch that a lot of people were thinking that, hey, were all the media samples that were going out, because there were quite a few, if they were eating up those 999 pieces being supplied to consumers, so they are separate. So I just wanted to get that out of the way. And I have done a time lapse build on this video, so if you haven't seen that, I did release that about 4 or 5 days ago. I'll throw that in the description to check out. So let's jump in and check out the board. If you're a PC enthusiast or a bit of a techie, you've probably heard or seen about the Aqua from ASRock. It was roughly 12 months ago, the X570 Aqua was announced and launched a few months after that. Fast forward to today and we have ASRock's second iteration of the Aqua lineup, which is based on Team Blue, the Z490 chipset. If you saw my first Aqua video, this one will follow suit. I'll check out the board in detail, do some testing, and finish off with a build, hopefully amazing you all. Jumping straight in, ASRock has yet again created not just a motherboard, but rather a whole experience with the Aqua. We get this beautiful white box with pearlescent text with specs on the back. I don't normally cover the unboxing process, but ASRock has put the effort in, so the least I can do is show this to you. Once opening the box, we're greeted with an envelope just like before, and yes, this one has been printed with the GGF events text. Inside the envelope is a card thanking you for your purchase and a little bit about the product. There's also a credit card sized card that resembles something like a club card. End users would have their run number out of 999 on theirs. Removing the next layer is the motherboard itself, and I'll jump over to that shortly. Under the motherboard are four compartments. The first houses driver CD, software setup guide, and quick installation manual. The second compartment holds a Wi-Fi antenna and four SATA cables. The third contains spare thermal pads, thermal paste and screws for the water block, SLI bridge, and M.2 screws. While the last compartment, you'll find an interesting set of included fittings to complete your custom water loop. These all include 14mm outer diameter hard tube compression fittings, which include 6 end fittings, 2 90 degree rotary compression fittings, 2 90 degree compression fittings, 2 stop fittings, and a neat mini ball valve. These all include the Aqua logo, which is a nice touch. But just one thing to note, I had troubles with frosted and chrome plated 14mm tubing and could not get either of those types to fit in any of the angled fittings, but they would install fine in any of the 6 end fittings. Moving over to the board, and what a beast it is. The Z490 Aqua comes in at 3.3 kilograms, and for reference, the Z490 Tai Chi weighs 1.45 kilograms. That's over double the weight. Aesthetics of the board are very much the same as the previous, with aluminum covering nearly the entirety of the board, but I feel ASRock has focused a little bit more on the block and how much coolant can actually be seen. We can see that in action soon. The board is EATX and measures 265 wide by 305 high. There's a small cutout for the SATA ports and a notch at the top and the bottom right hand edge of the board. A backplate has now been included, and I must say this looks very nice in person, with its mix of silver and brushed aluminum finish. It's a shame you'll never see this again once installed in a case. Thermal pads have been added that make contact on the back of the PCB for extra VRM cooling. The Z490 Aqua's water block only cools the CPU this time, and not the chipset as well, like on the X570 model. We all know the X570 chipset required that extra cooling. Instead, ASRock have added a holographic style window over the chipset, which looks kinda cool. Just under that is where the run number is printed. You may not have noticed this yet, but the IO cover actually houses an OLED display. ASRock definitely aren't the first to do something like this, but I must say this is a hefty size screen. This is basically a diagnostic display which shows post information, voltages, fan speeds, and temperatures. This can all be controlled by the BIOS, which is neat, so no extra software is required. I must admit, close up, the display is a little pixelated, but you don't normally use or operate the board so close. Once installed in a case on the desk, the display looked much clearer. I also appreciate how ASRock have left their normal Dr. Debug post display at the bottom of the board. This one does turn off once the board is posted and is in Windows. Of course, there is plenty of RGB on the Aqua. RGB is located on the IO cover that shines over the board. The block itself has plenty of internal RGB and also a strip that shines down over the PCI slots. And lastly, the hologram chipset heatsink has RGB as well.
ASRock have included four RGB headers on the board, a 12-volt 4-pin and a 5-volt 3-pin ARGB header can be found at the bottom, while two more of the same can be found at the top. RGB control can be done straight from the BIOS, and if you've seen my previous ASRock videos, this is a feature I love. No extra software is needed for controlling the motherboard's RGB or any of the four headers. Software will only be required for third-party syncing for, say, RGB memory or peripherals. Removing the water block requires the removal of 8 screws, 4 for the VRM, then 4 around the CPU. Once these are out, the block will simply pull off. I can't just get over how big this block is in both weight and height. With some Trident C RGB memory installed, you can see they're nearly at the same height. The block nearly consumes it, and the block itself comes in at 1.8 kilograms. Here we can see the block cools the CPU, and of course FETs, chokes, and that little acquainted 10 gigabit Ethernet chip as well. Maybe ASRock really had the inside goss on how much power the new 10th gen processors consumed. Now the block is off, let's take a closer look at the board. Power delivery for the board is via dual 8-pin EPS, which seems standard for most high-end Z490 boards. Power design is a 16-phase with 90A chokes and an ISL 69269 PWM. We recently tested the Z490 Tai Chi with this 12-phase design and had absolutely no issues there with stability, overclocking, or heat, so I feel we'll have no issues here as well. Memory support is up to DDR4 4800MHz plus OC. I threw in a set of my Teen Group Extreme 4133 BDI kit and was able to run a nice 4600MHz. PCIe layout is very much the same as on the Z490 Tai Chi, running at 16, 8 and 4 if all 3 slots are populated. The first 2 slots are PCIe Gen 4 compatible for future CPUs. Just a note that the 2 PCIe 1x slots do operate at Gen 2 speeds. This is due to the extra I/O connectivity on this board, and I'll touch base on that later. For M.2 slots, there are a total of 4 on the Z490 Aqua. 3 are Gen 3 and will work straight out of the box. The 4th labeled RKL_M2, which can only mean Rocket Lake, is Gen 4 only and will work with future CPUs. All the M.2 slots support PCIe NVMe SSDs, with the bottom 2 slots M.22 and M.23 supporting SATA M.2 SSDs as well. All M.2 slots are covered and cooled by thick thermal pads. For a quick NVMe test, I threw in a WD Black SN750 1TB NVMe SSD and tested dry performance and temperatures in each slot. As you can see, there are no issues here and is performing as expected. After copying 100GB of data to each drive, temperatures were pretty good, maxing out at around 60 degrees. Networking is rather decent on the Z490 Aqua, with the inclusion of an Aquantia 10GB adapter, a Realtek Dragon RTL8125BG 2.5GB adapter, and an 802.11ax Wi-Fi module for 2.4GB. With new boards, I always like to test out the networking for any issues. This time, instead of going through each test and showing you each transfer process, which drags on for a bit, I put them all in a chart to make it easier. Testing was performed via basic network transfer, with transferring 20 plus gigabytes of data each time. The host machine was spec'd with a 10 gigabit network adapter with an NVMe Gen 4 SSD. Also, a shout out to TP-Link for supplying me with their brand new Archer AX11000 wireless router for network testing. This thing is an absolute beast and is a great choice where extra Wi-Fi range is required. There are a total of 5 tests, 3 for the wireless, 1 for the 10 gigabit, and 1 for the 2.5 gigabit LAN. Network speeds were pretty much on point and what you'd expect to see. For audio, ASRock is stuck with a Realtek ALC1220 audio codec for their onboard solution, but have added an ESS Saber 9218 DAC for front panel audio with 130 dB signal to noise ratio, which is a nice touch. This is something the X570 Aqua lacked, and being a flagship board, I feel having something like this is a step in the right direction. 8 fan headers are located around the board, with all supporting the water pump feature. This is the same found on the Z490 Tai Chi. One thing I wish ASRock would add, and especially on a board like this, is a temp sensor in. This would allow water temperature monitoring via Windows for your custom loop. Moving on to the rear, and what a jam-packed I/O this is. You've probably heard me say this 100 times already, but ASRock has once again gone with their flexible I/O shield that gives you that perfect fitment in any chassis. First, we find a BIOS reset button and ASRock BIOS flashback button. This allows you to update the motherboard's BIOS without the need of a CPU or memory installed. The associated USB port is the first USB in the 4 stack. One HDMI 1.4 port can be found, supporting up to true 4K resolution at 30Hz. A total of 8 USB can be found on the rear, 4 USB 3.2 Gen 1 Type A ports running off the Intel Z490 chipset, 3 USB 3.2 Gen 2 Type A 10 gigabit ports, and 1 USB 3.2 Gen 2 Type C 10 gigabit port. Lastly on the rear I/O is the Thunderbolt 3 module, which is a beast. This unit includes two Type-C 40 gigabit Thunderbolt 3 ports or two 10 gigabit ports if using the USB protocol. You'll also find two mini DisplayPort 1.4 ports. These are to be linked to your dedicated GPU for a dedicated pass-through to the Thunderbolt ports for one single cable out. Other features include onboard power, reset, retry and safe boot buttons, one front panel Type-C USB 3.2 Gen 2 header running off the Intel Z490 chipset, and two USB 3.2 Gen 1 headers running off an ASMedia ASM 1074 hub.
Alrighty, so that's most of the board there. We'll jump in, check out the build, and then I'll show you the VRM results. So I'm actually really, really happy with how this build came out. I think the colors, the contrast, how simple and clean it is, everything just tied in really nicely. Now, before I wrap this video up and go over a bit more about this build, I just want to cover my VRM testing on the Aqua. Now, I didn't do the testing in this chassis. I used my PrimaChill test bench, which I do in most cases. That consisted of a 480 60mm XEEK radiator, had noise blocker IGB fans, had a single D5 driving the loop, and the loop consisted of the CPU and the VRM only, so there was no GPU included in the loop. Now I used my K-Type Pros for the testing, and they were on the FETs, the chokes, and on the back of the PCB behind the VRMs. Now I had no AVX offset, so ignore the CPU temperatures you see in this next graph because it is pretty hot, and I did back on a relatively high V-core just to get a bit of a stable OC so I could push as much wattage through the board to test out the VRMs. Now going over to my chart, so we can see I ran Prime 95 for 10 minutes. This was at least 10 minutes. I ran the smallest FFTs and with AVX on, and I had the CPU running at 5 gigahertz. I could also get 5.1, but it wasn't quite as stable, and I didn't really spend too much time trying to tinker and overclock with the CPU, and the power draw was about 315 to 320 watts. Now you can see that CPU is pretty scorching for a sort of a high-end water-cooled system, but you have to remember the VRMs are included now in this loop. So people who go with monoblocks and so on, a lot of the time they don't counter for the extra heat you are throwing into your loop. So with a board like this, or pretty much any high-end board that you're going to throw VRMs into a loop, I would at least go with two decent 360 radiators. I would never go with just a single 360 trying to drive CPU, VRMs, and then probably you're most likely going to add your GPU as well. So I'd stick to two good 360mm radiators. Now going on the temps, as I said, this was running for 10 minutes. Ambient temp was around 24 degrees. It didn't really change off 24 degrees for the time I ran it. The back of the VRM was 48 degrees. The chokes were 49 degrees and the FETs were 43 degrees. So pretty good temperatures all around. But once again, these are gonna be different than something like on an air-cooled system. When I tested the Tai Chi, those VRMs were air-cooled. So pretty much those temps are gonna be the same no matter where you are, just as long as your ambient temperature is pretty good. But coming down to these VRMs being water-cooled with this block, it's gonna sort of affect a lot of other things in your case, whether you're running one GPU, two GPUs, depending on your water-cooled system. As I said before, if you're running one radiator, two radiators, the type of fans, your airflow, and so on. But for my test setup on my test bench, these were the results, and I did find these were pretty good, especially when you're pulling 300 plus watts out of this CPU. All right, so that's pretty much temperatures out of the way. Now, this is probably the worst case scenario for these tests because I am throwing a heap of wattage at it, and probably you're not gonna pick up this board, just be running something like Prime 95, or you're probably not gonna be running the AVX instruction set for this board for what you're doing it for. Most people will be using this for gaming and so on, but I just wanted to see what it was gonna be in worst case. If you do use this for gaming, temperatures are going to be way, way less. All right, now jumping on to some other things before I quickly cover over the build. Now, the OLED display I covered earlier, I'll throw some shots of the OLED display now that it's in the case, because before I had it on the test bench and I didn't want to show you sort of in this case beforehand before I showed you the final build. Now, I would like it. I did say it was controlled by the BIOS, which I think is good. I never like third-party apps and extra apps you need in Windows, but in saying that, I think a Windows app would be good for this OLED screen. I'm not saying it has to be running all the time, but say you want to change something in the settings, because there's a heap of options you can turn on and off for this OLED display. You can turn on different voltages, you can read different temperatures, different fan speeds, and so on. So maybe a Windows app that you can just start it up, tick the changes you want to do, and then you can just close it. Something like that. Just something that doesn't have to be running, but save you having to restart your system, go into the BIOS, enable what you want, save it, and then go back into Windows. Even just an option, an app that you could turn it off and on, so you don't have to always have it on. You can turn it off, and if you want to check out some stats, you can turn it on. I did speak to ASRock about that. At this stage, they said there's just control via the BIOS, so you might see that in the future. Now, I said this in my Tai Chi video, I think they need a non-blocked version of this board. Now, as I said earlier, this board is limited to 999 pieces. I don't think that's enough for something like this. Now, it is expensive, so I'm not saying that everyone's gonna rush out and buy this straight away, but I think having a non-blocked version, pretty much the same as the AMD Ryzen setup, where they had the X570 Aqua, then they had the Creator, which was a very, very similar PCB, although that one wasn't EATX, but it had the same features, the Thunderbolt, similar VRM setup and all that, but that one was half the cost. So the only motherboard down from the Aqua now is the Tai Chi, and that is a very, very different board, different PCB, completely different VRM setup, completely all together. So if they could release this board without the block, you could save quite a bit, and I think a lot of people would go down that route. And in saying that, I do think a lot of these boards are pretty much pre-ordered already. So having a non-limited version of this board without the block would be a good way to go. Now that puts me down to price. You're looking at $1,699 Australian, so that's $1,699 Australian, that's a PC case gear, or on Newegg US, it was $1,099 in US. Now, yes, that is expensive. Believe it or not, this is not the most expensive Z490 board out there. But in saying that, purely having 999 models, it does make it that niche product. So you are going to expect price is going to be up there. So I'll leave that down to you if you think this is a worthy buy. But yeah, I definitely think there should be another model step down without the block. Now moving over to my build I did over here, as I said earlier, I think it turned out really, really good. Probably better than what I expected. Now, pretty much the hardest thing to do when I do these new builds, especially focused around the product, is especially choosing the case. I always like to go down a path where I've never used the case before. I don't often recycle the cases and use them twice. I just think I like to provide you guys with different builds each time. Now, I do want to have a shout out to M-Wave. They did supply the Cooler Master C700M, so thank you for them for sending that over. And I looked quite a while for cases that would work well with this board. You may remember last time, the X570 Aqua, I used the Inwin Tau 2.0, but I have used that before, and I didn't want the build to be or look exactly the same. So I went with the C700M, and I think the contrast works well. You've got the black, and then you sort of got this this sort of silvery matte satin silver that covers around the front sides and top and so on. So that did blend in really nice. Now, I did go with the BitsPower distro. Now, BitsPower has some interesting distros. They actually are side mounted, so They don't go on the back wall next to the motherboard tray. They stick out a bit, and I think that works pretty good. Functionality of those aren't too bad. The only issue is with the DDC pump being here, because it pushes in a bit, it only allows you to put very, very slim radiators at the front. So that limits this case to a slim rad at the top and a slim rad at the front. If you didn't have this pump there, I could have gone with, say, something like a 60 millimeter thick radiator at the front. So just keep in mind with going like that. I think if Bits Power could have an adapter where you could remove the DDC off this distro, you could put the DDC somewhere else, like underneath, you would be able to have a much thicker radiator installed in there. Now, some other things I did you may not notice. I did the distro backing. I added a back on, you can just see it moving here. I didn't really secure it in, but I added a back on this distro just so you couldn't see through, because I was always going to use this type of clear see-through coolant with the blue dye. I didn't want to see the extra fittings and tubings running behind it, and I didn't want to see through. So this took quite a bit. I just used I've said this before, I used clear anodized aluminum. This is about 2 millimeters thick. I simply pulled the distro apart, undid all the screws, traced around it all, marked out where all the holes were going to be, because I needed to put like stop fittings back in, and all the fittings had to screw back in. And then I just simply cut it out with the jigsaw. And I think that does give a nice contrast. And by doing that, I was able to put the Aqua logo on that bit of backing. And then when it comes back on, you can see that through it. And by saying that all my fittings are behind it, to get all these runs parallel, this run here that runs along here actually goes into this port here. So I actually got a right angle going up and then some extenders and a right angle going out. And this one down here just happens to line up exactly. I wanted them like that so the spacing was relatively equal between, mainly so they were nice and symmetrical. I could have had a right angle fitting coming straight out here and this one would have lined up exactly to here, but that didn't quite look right because I had a nice curve here and then I had a right angle fitting coming out of here, and the symmetry was a little bit off. So by adding this backing, I could bulk out the fittings on the back and have everything nice and straight. And when the radiators are joined together up here, I do have flex tubing, so having this backing on does hide all that as well. And I think the coolant really does pop a little bit more, as if this backing wasn't on, it would have just been black, and I think the coolant wouldn't have popped as much. Now, another area I added, you may have seen this in the timelapse video, is I added a bit of a motherboard tray to the right of the motherboard. That's simply just a square bit of the same clear anodized aluminum, 2 millimeters thick. And the only hole that is cut out of that is for the 24 pin, just something nice and clean. And that is just screwed on to the chassis. I managed to pick up holes that were already in the case. And then I just put holes in the screw I made, and they just screwed straight in. Now, if you wanted to add more holes, you can just simply do that. You can do that for starter, say something like USB. But for me, I just wanted the 24 pin to keep it nice and clean. Now, another thing you may have noticed was the Bits Power GPU block I used. Now, they do come with their own black backplate. They are a nice one, but I wanted to change it up a bit. I've done this before in my Project Avalanche build with their backplates. Now, I haven't had an issue with this so far. I use the Founders Edition, so the RTX NVIDIA Founders Edition backplates work on pretty much any GPU block I've tried. You just have to use the screws that come with the GPU block, and you may need to widen the holes in the Founders backplate because they are very, very fine holes. So you can pick the just backplates, pick them up off eBay. I found someone doing them in China. I think they are quite expensive. They're about $50 just for a backplate, and it just comes as is. Now, I've done that before in a few builds, and I think the contrast works really nice, especially with this silver themed build, because then I don't have this big black area down here, and then I've got that nice RTX 2080 Ti logo in there. Another area is the Bits Power pre-bent chrome. Now, yes, Bits Power do this. You may have seen this in the timelapse build. They do the chrome now, which is nice. I'm not sure on the price, unfortunately, but they do come in a pack of four, which is nice. So yeah, I want to shout out to Bits Power for sending all the water cooling, M-Wave for the chassis, and of course, ASRock for sending the board to check out. And yeah, I just hope you enjoyed this video. I hope you enjoyed this review, the build I did. And once again, thank you for watching, and see you in the next one.